The Lord is with you. Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Come, you will conceive in your womb and give birth to a son, and you will call his name Jesus.
How can this be, since I've been with no man?
The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power from the Most High will overshadow you. And the holy offspring shall be called the Son of God.
Son of God?
Mary, even your cousin Elizabeth has conceived a son in her old age. For nothing said by God can be impossible.
Let it be done to me according to your word.
Into this moment this morning, but welcome to the Salvation Army. Welcome to the second Sunday of Advent. What we're attempting to do this morning is set the scene for you around the manger. And I'll get the couple of business things out of the way to start with. Our offering baskets are on the side. Please feel free to do that whenever you'd like to as part of our worship this morning. And an announcement from Ken. Lovely Ed, his funeral was during the week. And the YouTube video is not public, okay? But if you would like to watch and have that link, please see Ken or ring the office during the week. You're very welcome. The family have got it, and they would love anyone here, part of Ed's church, to have that. So please feel free to do that. We're focusing on the manger. We're standing on holy ground, and I want to bring you into an atmosphere of being in that stable, that room, whatever the situation was in Bethlehem, that very busy night, that very noisy night, that very special night when God came amongst us. Emmanuel, God with us. It's hard to create an atmosphere in today's age. It's hard to create an atmosphere when we're sitting in this modern room in rows of seats, wearing church clothes and shoes on our feet. I'm going to take my shoes off this morning because I want to invite you to do so also. We're standing and we're in the presence of God. Came as a baby. He didn't come any other way. He came as a baby. And I know from the birth of my just fairly recent grandchildren that there was no great big fanfare. It was a noisy atmosphere. It was an emotional atmosphere. We certainly weren't in fancy clothes and shoes. So this morning, I just invite you to get comfortable. If you want to stay in your seats, feel free. If you would like to come and sit closer around our beautiful portrayal of the manger this morning, I invite you to do so. Just whatever you would like to do this morning. And just before I light the second Advent candle, which is our candle of peace, I'm just wanting to set the atmosphere by playing Holy Ground. So soak it in. and try and put yourself in that first manger scene on Christmas morning. Today is that you would feel Jesus all around this Advent season right now, that you would allow him just to touch your life again as we stand in his presence on holy ground. Dear God, as we journey down this Advent road, grant us the courage to make peace, peace in our hearts, peace in our homes, peace in our communities. And Lord, I just pray over my church congregation here today that you will grant peace to every family represented here. Lord, whatever our situations are, wherever our families are, spread far and wide. Lord, even if we're on our own and feel really alone this Christmas time, Father, I pray that you would come so close that no one would ever have to feel lonely again. Father, I thank you that the hope of the world, you, Jesus, you came and entered this world so simply. Father, help us just to grasp a little, catch a glimpse of the wonder of it all again this Christmas time. What you did for us, the journey that you started that first Christmas night. Lord, we love you. And we just rest in your presence in this place this morning. And we pray for every other church community that meets in our city, around our country, and as Sunday dawns around the world. Father, that your Advent peace would be felt. Lord, especially in the country in which you were born. Father, we lift those people up to you. Every family. They feel the same about their children as what we do. We stand in your presence, Lord.
This isn't the way I planned it, God. No way. Not at all. My child being born in a stable. This isn't the way I thought it would be. A cave with sheep and donkeys, hay and straw. My wife giving birth with only stars to hear her pain. This isn't at all what I imagined. Nope, no way. I imagine family. I imagine grandmothers. I imagine neighbors clustered outside the door and friends standing by my side. I imagine the house erupting with the first cry of the infant. Slaps on the back. Loud laughter. Jubilation. That's how I thought it would be. But now, who's going to celebrate with us now? The sheep? The shepherds? The stars? It doesn't seem right. I mean, what kind of husband am I? I provide no midwife to help my wife give birth? Not even a bed to rest her back. Her pillow is the blanket from my donkey. Did I miss something? Well, did I, God? When you sent the angel and spoke of the son being born, this isn't what I pictured. I envisaged Jerusalem, the temple, the priest, the people gathered to watch, maybe even a pageant, a parade. I mean, this is the Messiah. Or, if not born in Jerusalem, how about Nazareth? Wouldn't Nazareth have been better? At least there, I have my house and my business. Out here, what do I have? A weary mule, a stack of firewood, and a pot of warm water. This is not the way I wanted it to be. Forgive me for asking, but is this how God enters a world? No. The coming of the angel I accepted. The questions people asked about the pregnancy, I can tolerate that. The trip to Bethlehem, fine. But why a birth in a stable, God? Any minute now, Mary will give birth, not to a child, but to the Messiah. Not to an infant, but to God. That's what the angel said. That's what Mary believes. And God, my God, that's what I want to believe. But surely you can understand. It's not easy. And all this, it's quite bizarre. Now, I'm accustomed to such strangeness. God, I'm a carpenter. I make things fit. I square off the edges. I follow the plumb line. I measure twice before I cut once. Surprises are not the friend of a builder, you know. I like to know the plan. I like to see the plan before I begin. But this time, I'm not the builder, am I? This time, I'm a tool. A hammer in your hand. A chisel in your grip. This project is yours, right, God? It's not mine. I guess it is foolish for me to question you. Forgive my struggling. Trust doesn't come easy to me, God. But you never said it would be easy, did you? One final thing, Father. The angel you sent, any chance you could send another? Well, if not an angel, maybe a person. I really don't know anyone around here, and some company would be nice. Maybe an innkeeper or a traveler. Even a shepherd would do.
I just invite you to sing with us. You can stand if you want to, remain seated. You just do whatever you want to this morning.
Oh, Kia ora whānau. Good morning, family. This is by Ruth Cho Simmons. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth, all their host. He gathers the waters of the sea as a heap. He puts the deeps in storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. Miracles happen every day. They may not look like the literal parting of the sea, but God makes a way through the wilderness each and every day of our lives, starting first and foremost with the way of salvation through the promised Saviour of the world, Jesus of Nazareth. The psalmist didn't know the wonders of the virgin birth and the sinless life, burial, and resurrection of Christ, but he experienced a profound sense of awe when he considered God's handiwork as the creator who spoke the word into existence, the world into existence. Day by day, God continues to hold the world together by his power. From the sun that calls this day into order, piercing through the darkest night, to the blazing sunset that lingers past the day's toils, God puts his power and sovereign care on display. He still calls us to respond with wonder and awe. I heard the story of how during the Christmas season of 1995, a team of scientists decided to point the Hubble Space Telescope at a small starless spot of sky and take pictures of it. For 10 days, despite the enormity of the cost to investigate something that seemed apparently unspectacular, this is what they discovered. Hubble's images delighted the astronomical community. Formerly known as the Hubble Deep Field, the so-called blank spot in the sky contained some 3,000 galaxies of all shapes, colours and sizes, like presents under the tree on Christmas morning. If that causes you to marvel, it should. God and his design for us is so much more complex and extravagant than we know. In the dizzying array of technology and man-made creations, it's easy to be in awe of the work of our own hands, forgetting that the very breath we breathe is a gift from God. So, does this Christmas season find you full of awe and wonder? Or a bit jaded from the numbing strain of busyness? It's hard to be full of praise and adoration when we're filled with worry and self-striving. Are you tempted to discount the seemingly unremarkable corners of your life? What if the God of wonders is at work in ways more than you can possibly imagine? The true miracle of Christmas isn't simply the virgin birth. It's much greater than even such an impossibility. No, the miracle of Christmas is in this, that a holy God made a way for all who believe to come to him by first coming to us. Let that sink in. God's promises, fulfilled by God himself, are more than remarkable. They merit a response, not to get busy, but to fall down in reverence and awe of our great God. And for this great love and pursuit from the Father, he doesn't seek a response of show or extravagance. He desires our surrendered praise. Oh, that we might bow low and respond with lifted hearts, declaring, "You are God Almighty, and we stand in awe of you." Let's pray. Father, you are worthy of our praise. When we consider your faithfulness through the works of your hands, through the gift of your Son, and through the ways that you care for us day by day, we're humbled. And remember once again, you are God, and we are not. Lord, please forgive us for the ways that we try to steal your glory and trust in ourselves. You draw near to us each day and put on display the ways you are still sovereign and good. May we give you the adoration and praise you deserve, not just this Christmas season, but each and every day. Amen.
Rejoice! Rejoice! I bring you good tidings of great joy, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. You will find a child wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.
Are you well?
I have been given the strength I prayed for. Strength from God. And from you. He is for all mankind. We are each given a gift.
Mother and child.
sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name, tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples, for great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. John Piper famously said, missions exist because worship doesn't. In other words, God desired relationship with us from the beginning. We were created to praise him as our good and faithful God. When we tell the good news of Jesus' birth, life, death, and resurrection, we extend the invitation to return to God's desire for his people to worship him, to love him and be loved by him. This is the ultimate goal of God's pursuit of his people. While Jesus' birth served to relieve a hurting world, to bring hope to the hopeless, and to fulfill God's promise to reconcile his people to himself, those who anticipated his birth responded first and foremost in worship. All those who came to the manger came with bowed knees, humbled hearts, and exuberant praise. Jesus, even in the form of an infant, was God with us. And in his presence, even the wise men knew their place. They brought gifts fit for a king because they knew he was worthy and worthy of treasuring. How that first Christmas contrasts to our upside-down ideas of treasure and treasuring today. The simplicity and humble context of Christ's birth is widely different than the extravagant display of stuff and self-gratification that marks much of modern-day Christmas celebrations in the West. While there's nothing inherently harmful about beautiful decorations, lavish gifts, holiday parties, or memories made with friends and family, so many miss the true worship they were made for when they settle for the worship of lesser things that don't really satisfy. Like the newest tech gadget, the Pinterest-worthy decor, or getting the gift you really wanted, or the affirmation you believe you deserve. If you long for something that doesn't truly satisfy and only causes you to grasp more anxiously in striving for it, you're worshipping something other than Jesus. You see, we can't truly encounter Christ the Messiah without the awe and wonder, the response of faith, the repentance, the thanksgiving, the love, and the worship he deserves. This part of our Advent's journey is the heart's response to the promise of God through Christ, the Saviour. If we find our response different than that of true worship, today is a good day to come to Jesus, to give up that which we treasure most. If we're honest, that's ourselves. So come to Jesus, the King. Come to the manger and surrender your greatest treasures. They don't even compare to him. Jesus is worthy of worship, and because of God's faithfulness through Christ, we are made worthy to worship him. Joy to the world.
Emmanuel, he this Christmas day. God is with us, Christ our Savior, Jesus our Emmanuel. He shall reign a king forever, the hope of Israel. This Christmas day, our song shall be. God is with us, Christ our Savior, Jesus and Emmanuel. He shall reign our King forever, the hope of Israel.
Lift up your voices. God is with us. Emmanuel, God with us, the hope of Israel, the hope of the world. It kind of blows my mind if you think about the enormity of that. God, this massive God of creation, the God who created those galaxies in this dark space of nothingness, would come to a manger, come and dwell with us as a human. Jesus came to be with us and to show us what God is like, to show us love, to show us hope, that we might know God. And we have this amazing privilege that God is close with us. There is hope. There is love. Sometimes when we look at the world, there's not a lot of love to spare, but God came down. And it's not a once upon a time fairy tale kind of story that happened 2,000 years ago. God came down and he lived and he's still with us today. Not just 2,000 years ago where he walked on the earth. While we anticipate at Christmas, the coming of baby Jesus. You'll note that baby Jesus isn't quite in the manger yet. We know that God is with us always. And he is here with us now.
who said that he'll never leave us nor forsake us. And Jesus, who knows what it was like to be human and live in this on this earth, he knows our experiences, and he knows each of our desires. And he's given us different gifts and different purposes to share this hope and this love with others. So this is a hope of Jesus that we get to share with others, Emmanuel, God with us. And earlier this week, I saw a post on Instagram, which probably just sums everything up. A friend shared by a pastor named Ian Simpkins. It says this: Emmanuel equals God with us. So that means he is with us in the emergency room, in the divorce lawyer's office, during finals, changing nappies. He is with us in prison, on the first date, during the ugly cry. Anyone ugly cry? He is with us in the drop-off line. He is with us in therapy, at the checkout, in the delivery room, doing the dishes. He is with us on the bus, at the custody hearing, at the table, in AA. He is with us in the waiting room, during chemo, in recovery, at the funeral. He is with us today, tomorrow, on December 25th, and every day after. And God not only wants to bring peace to you, he wants to bring peace through you. There are people in your life right now whose lives are broken, loved ones whose dreams have been shattered, co-workers who are helpless. You have neighbors and acquaintances who have gone through tragedy and are trying to pick up the pieces. The peace and the hope that God has for you is also a peace that he wants to shine through you. And Jesus said to his followers, "You are the light of the world," in Matthew 5. So let's bring some light to this world. So as we have contemplated the manger this morning, I pray those different readings and the words of the songs have spoken to you. Be encouraged that God knows what you're going through. He is with you, and we have this hope to share with others. So let us pray together. God, we thank you that you are Emmanuel, God with us, that you would come and stand beside us in whatever we're going through. We pray that we can continue to share that with others during this Christmas season, and all the hustle and bustle and the stress and the financial burdens sometimes. We pray that we would be able to share your light, your hope, and your peace with others, so that they might know that you are close by and that you care. Lord, I pray for our family and everybody's situations, all the things that we've gone through this year, the loss of loved ones, loss of family members. We thank you that you know and you are close, that you are with us, and that you love us. And I pray that for each person, they would know your extravagant love more and more today and every day in this season. We thank you, Emmanuel. We thank you for being with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We invite you to stand and sing with us another Emmanuel song as we close our time together.
What hope we hold this solid night, a king is born in Bethlehem. Our journey long we seek the light that leads to the home in manger ground. What fear we felt in the silent day, but broken by a baby's cry, rejoice in the hallowed manger ground. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, God incarnate.
I did want to share with you some very happy news of two of our very dear young people that come from here and their roots are still here. Jessica Platt in Wellington, I think most of you know Jess, and our Daniel Burns were being enrolled this morning at Cuba Street as senior soldiers. And we praise God for that this week. I'm sure we have some very proud parents. Shane, Sal's at home sick. Sal, if you're watching this, we're thinking about you. And John and Fiona have gone to Wellington to have some family time. So we are very much part of that family journey, that celebration today, as those young people, amongst others down there, step forward as senior soldiers of the Salvation Army, declaring who they are following publicly and who they belong to. Amen. So go this morning, family, enjoy some fellowship time. We've kept it short again for that reason. We want this Christmas Advent time to be a time of fellowship and remembering what Nathan said to us last week, that fellowship is the simplest form of worship. So go and enjoy that. Emmanuel with you, Emmanuel with me. God is with us all. Amen.